shall we gather at the river, where bright angel feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God.
All right, well, good morning and welcome to our quote-unquote Sunday school lesson for the weekend of July the 4th and the 5th. And this week we're actually going to be starting in a new Sunday school book. We're going to move into the next quarter. It's going to be July, August, and September. And as always, if you need a copy of the Sunday school lesson, we do have the books available at the church. But if you're at home and need a copy, it is linked in the description above. There is a download link. You can download a copy of the lesson and keep it with you, and follow it as we go along through this lesson. And just a quick announcement, just as a reminder, we will be starting our evening face-to-face services. It'll be Sunday, July the 5th at 6 o'clock. So that means our new schedule will be Sunday mornings at 11 o'clock and Sunday evenings at 6 o'clock. We will be having live face-to-face services as well as streaming those live on Facebook. And then we will continue to do our Sunday school lessons on Saturdays at 10 a.m. That'll just be a broadcast, no live service there. And then Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock, we'll have a midweek Bible study, also a live broadcast, no face-to-face for right now. And we're going to look at going back to live face-to-face for those services in August. But as for now, that's going to be our schedule. And we do also post the videos to our YouTube channel later in the week, so you can go back and look at those there or on the church's Facebook page. Either way, they're always going to be there for you. But as we move into the lesson for this morning, we're going to move into start talking about the prophet Samuel. And again, we're going to be looking this morning at 1 Samuel chapter 1, verses 9 through 11 and 20 through 28. And before we get into the actual material for this lesson, I do want to read the introduction to the actual quarter that we're going into. It says here, it says, the prophet Samuel, like the book which bears his name, comes in as a connecting link between the judges and kings of Israel. He belonged to a transition period. It was appointed to him to pilot the nation between two stages of its history, from a republic to a monarchy, from a condition of somewhat casual and indefinite arrangements to one of a more systematic and orderly government. The great object of his life was to secure that this change should be made in a way most beneficial for the nation, and especially most beneficial for its spiritual interest. Care must be taken that while becoming like the nations and having a king, Israel shall not become like them in religion, but shall continue to stand out in hearty and unswerving allegiance to the law and covenant of their fathers, God. Samuel was the last of the judges and, in a sense, the first of the prophets. He was the last of the judges, but not in a military judge, but a ruling like Samson by physical strength, but by high spiritual qualities and prayer. Not so much wrestling against flesh and blood as against principalities and powers and the rulers of darkness of this world and spiritual wickedness in high places. In this respect, his function as judge blended with his work as prophet. Before him, the prophetic office was but a casual illumination. Under him, it becomes a more steady and systematic light. He was the first of a succession of prophets whom God placed side by side with the kings and priests of Israel to supply that fresh moral and spiritual force which the prevailing worldliness of the one and formalism of the other rendered so necessary for the great ends for which Israel was chosen. With some fine exceptions, the king and the priests would have allowed the seed of Abraham to drift away from the noble purposes for which God had called them. Conformity to the world in spirit, if not in form, was the prevailing tendency. The prophets were raised up to hold a nation firmly to the covenant, to vindicate the claims of its heavenly king, to thunder judgments against the idolatry and all rebellion, and pour words of comfort into the redemption of Israel. Of this order of God's servants, Samuel was the first, and it was also the greatest. He says he was called as he was in this office at a transition period. It was very important and a great calling. It was a work for which no ordinary man was needed and for which no ordinary man was found. This brief summary of Samuel's work justifies us in claiming a special importance for this position of Jewish history. Independently of the interests connected with the development of two such extraordinary characters as Saul and David, and with the many remarkable persons grouped around them, such as Eli and Jonathan, and the brave soldiers who formed the court of the two kings. And our lesson for this fourth quarter will continue the history of Israel through the reign of David. So that kind of gives us, it wets our whistle just a little bit of what we're going to be going into over the next 3 months. And we're going to start out talking about the birth of Samuel and talking about Samuel's life and Samuel's, not really a reign or rule, but as the prophet and the leader of the nation of Israel during that time. It says that the time that we're going to be talking about this morning is going to be about the birth of Samuel. And it says Samuel was born about B.C. 1171. That was a long time ago. That was a few years ago. That was 1,171 years before Christ was born. So that so if you're doing your good math, that was about almost 3,200 years before Christ was born. Or before, because Christ has been gone and ascended into heaven for 2,000, and then you go 1,137 before that is when Samuel's born. So we're talking about a long time ago. But it says the exact date is uncertain because we don't really have certainties for those dates that long ago. But it says Samuel was born in Ramah, which is also called Ramathon, and Shiloh was the religious capital of Israel at the time, and it was about 20 miles north of Jerusalem. So that's kind of the area and the and what we're going to be looking at and talking about this morning. But our golden text actually comes out of Psalm chapter 22 verse 6, or not Psalm, Proverbs chapter 22 verse 6, and it says, "Train a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." And that's important for this lesson this morning, because what we're going to actually be talking about is Samuel and how Samuel's mother dedicated him to the work of the temple, and how that is gained some great importance. The actual lesson aim even says, parents should fully surrender their children to God and be willing for Him to use them in His service, even if they are taken from home to other scenes and other lands. And I know that is something that's easier said than done. It's easy to say, "Oh, I'm going to dedicate this child to the Lord," but then things happen and situations come up, and then we wonder, "Oh, should I take back some control? Should I deal with this in some way?" But in reality, we need to give a child over to the Lord, and then we need to do our part to train that child up the best that we can in the fear and admonition of the Lord, I believe is what the King James says. But train a child up in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it, or not turn from it, meaning he will understand and realize what is that root that's been planted in him. And the hope and the prayer and the scripture says that they won't depart from it. That will always be there with them. And it takes a lot of trust in God to be able to do that and to be able to just give your children over to God. But the introduction to our lesson, it says this. It says, "Hannah," which is Samuel's mother, "stands at the front of her generation as a woman of deep devotion and determined prayer. Unable to bear the reproach of barrenness or not being able to have children, she determined to have God do the unusual for her by asking Him to open her womb and permit the birth of a child. Consequently, she prayed and wept simultaneously, vowing that if a child should indeed be hers, she would loan him to the Lord for His service." Now, that word "loan," and that's what the Bible says, and in the King James, it does use the word "loan." And it's not a loan as in what we would think a loan. It's not a you go to the bank, you borrow money, and then you pay that money back. When we're talking about a loan to the Lord, we're talking about a dedication, giving that over to the Lord, saying, "Lord, You've given me this. I am dedicating it back to You." And it says, "Time marches on, and soon, according to the time of life, she bears a man-child, weans him, and takes him to the priest at the temple, and there dedicates him to the service of the Lord, as she had previously promised." She made a promise to God, and she kept her promises. And with the lad given to the service of the Lord, she leaves the temple and yearly returns with a new coat for him, recognizing that a year's growth would necessitate a new garment. And think about that, though. Think about having this child when it gets old enough to start to learn and things on its own and different things. You take that child, it's probably 4, 5, maybe 6 years old, and takes that child over to the temple and gives that child to the temple in the service of the temple, and she only comes back once a year to bring the child the things that the child needs. And it's not like it is even today, where you have internet and calling and all these different things. And as hard as that would be today, think about then, when there were great distances between the two of them, and the only thing she could do is trust God to take care of that child. But it says, it is little wonder that the lad grew up to be the saintly Samuel, who stands out as stewardly as God's man of his generation. Lessons abound in this story today. Some of them are as follows. Number one, fervent prayer is productive prayer. Number two, mothers have a tremendous influence in the lives of their children. Number three, God specializes in impossible cases such as Hannah's barren womb. Number four, it pays to believe God for the supernatural. And number five, mothers will do well to leave their children in the hands of the Lord. After all, He knows what's best for them. And actually, I would extend that and say, you know, God not only knows what's best for our children, God knows what's best for all of us. God knows what we need and how we should act, how we should react, and all the things. God knows best is just really the only way you can put it. So, let's get into our scripture this morning. There's not a lot of deep thought in this scripture. It says what it says and means what it means. But we're going to get into it and look at it and kind of work our way through it this morning. So the first verse says, "Once when they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, Hannah stood up. And now Eli the priest was sitting on a chair by the doorpost of the Lord's temple." Now, what's going on here is, Shiloh was this religious center there, and what they would do is they would make a pilgrimage. Tradition was about 3 times a year, but a lot of people in that day, they would just go once a year. And they would make this pilgrimage and celebrate one of the feasts, Passover or something like that. And they would celebrate that there in Shiloh. They would offer sacrifices at the temple, or even before that, the tabernacle, all these different things. So Hannah and her husband had made this trip to Shiloh, and they were eating and drinking, and they were there at the temple or around the out part of the temple. And it says there came a time that Hannah stood up, and I don't know what caused Hannah to stand up. Probably she felt impressed upon her by the Lord to pray and to offer up her prayer to God. But it says she stood up, and Eli noticed her stand up, and he was, it says, sitting at the door by the doorpost of the Lord's temple. He was sitting not really on a throne, but kind of on a seat, on the judgment seat maybe, or just the area where they would do the business of the temple there. And so he was sitting there, and he takes notice of this. In our Sunday school book, I like what it says here. It gives us a little bit more perspective too. It says, "At the time of the birth of Samuel and during his younger days, the high priest resided there, and the religious families of the people were in the habit of making an annual pilgrimage to this central sanctuary of the worship of Jehovah. The seat upon which Eli is represented as usually sitting was evidently a chair or throne of state, where the high priestly judge sat at certain times to administer justice and transact business." So that just kind of, you know, just reinforces what we've already talked about and already said. But what does she do? When she stands up, something happens, and she does something. It says, "In bitterness of soul, Hannah wept much and prayed to the Lord." In bitterness of soul, she wept much and prayed to the Lord. Her soul, she was impacted and affected, and her soul, to the depths of her soul, was hurt. So she prays out to God, and she's weeping, and she's not really very auditory. She's not saying anything, but just her weeping and her moaning, that inward prayer, and that expression probably on her face is what got Eli's attention, and got him to realize and see something's going on. Now, at first, he misunderstands. We'll get into that in a minute, but she is pouring herself out to God. And our book again says Hannah could not bear the affliction of barrenness, so she grew discontented. And then it goes on, it says Hannah was in bitterness of soul and prayed unto the Lord and wept sore. She went to the one who hears, who understands, and answers. The only person that could help was God. So she goes to God and pours out her soul to God. And this is what she says. And she made a vow saying, O Lord Almighty, if you will only look upon your servant's misery and remember me and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head. And there's two things. So, you know, her prayer is she's praying out to God, Lord, just give me a child and remember me. Don't forget about me and give me a son. And she says, and to show how serious I am, if I have a son, I will give him back to you. I will dedicate him to the service of the temple. It says no razor will ever be used on his head. And that's a Nazarite vow, and that's a lifetime vow. That's not just a normal vow of temple service, but a lifetime vow. The book says here, kneeling down in the inner court with sight of Eli, whose throne in the porch overlooked the whole inner space, Hannah prays for a male child. And with her prayer, she also makes a twofold vow in case her request is granted. The son given to her is first to serve not as for a stipulated number of years, as was the law for the Levites, but for life. See, the law says if you dedicate a child to the Lord, they serve for a certain number of years, and then they go back and do their own thing. This was a dedication for life. It says, and secondly, he is to be a Nazarite. So by Hannah's first vow, Samuel was devoted to the service of the sanctuary, and by the second, to a holy and a consecrated life. She dedicated that child to the Lord. And we symbolically do that when we dedicate children, when we baptize young children and dedicate them to the Lord. We are dedicating them to the service of the Lord, but we're also making a vow that we will bring them up in the ways of the Lord, and we will try our best to lead them down the right path and lead them the right way and bring them up in a Christian household. And that's what the dedication that we make. And it's similar to this because we're dedicating ourselves and our family and our children, everything, to the service of the Lord. And so that kind of ends there in verse 11. But then the lesson doesn't pick back up until about verse 20. But there are some things that go on in between there. And I'm just going to read what the book has to say about that. But it says, Hannah's prayer was long and earnest, but in silence. Unused to then such real prayer, Eli, as he marked the quivering lips, the prostrate form, the face flushed with earnestness, came to the coarse conclusion that she was drunk, and with equal coarseness bids her to put away her wine from her, that is, to go and sleep off the effect of her debauchery. And what he's not used to seeing someone just absolutely pouring themselves out to God like that. That was something that he had not seen people actually do there at the temple. So he just came to the natural conclusion she had had too much to drink and she was defiling the temple, which irritated him. So he told her to go home and sleep it off. But we know that wasn't the case. And she corrects him. It says here in our blessing book, it says, Hannah abhorred that kind of evil, which Eli accused her of. Count not thine handmaid for a daughter of Belial, is what she tells him. And then, convinced by the modesty and the earnestness of her answer, Eli retracts his accusation. He gives her his blessing and prays that her petition may be granted. Hannah, comforted by such words spoken by the high priest, returned to the sacrificial feast, which apparently was not yet finished, and joined in it, for she did eat, and her countenance was no more sad. So his affirmation of her was an indication that God heard her prayer and that God was going to answer her prayer. That was that assurance and that comfort that came from that. And so, but that's what happens in between there. But we pick up again in verse 20, and it says, so in the course of time, Hannah conceived and gave birth to a son. She named him Samuel because I asked the Lord for him. And Samuel is basically answered prayer. She said she gave him the name Samuel because Samuel was an answer to her prayer. It says, one thing in the book, it says, we should remember that all of our children are God's gifts, and we have a responsibility to dedicate them to Him and to see that they are properly brought up. God's gift. They are all, in a way, our Samuel, because they are gifts from God, and we're given them to raise in the Lord. And then in verse 21, it says, when the man Elkanah, that was Hannah's husband, went up with all of his family to offer the annual sacrifice to the Lord and to fulfill his vow, it says, but Hannah did not go. She said to her husband, after the boy is weaned, I will take him and present him before the Lord, and he will live there always. And so... So it's time for that yearly trip, but the baby's not old enough. Samuel's not old enough. So she says, you go ahead. I'm going to stay here with him. I'm going to keep him until he is weaned and ready and eating food and all those things. And he is mature enough to understand what he'll be doing there and those types of things. Like I said, probably a 4, 5, 6 years old around there. She says, I'm going to keep him here and raise him up to that point, and then I'm going to take him to the temple, give him to the temple, and there he'll always be. And do what seems best to you, Elkiah, her husband told her. Stay here until you have weaned him. Only may the Lord make good his word. So the woman stayed at home and nursed her son until she had weaned him. And after he was weaned, she took the boy with her, young as he was, along with the 3-year-old bull, an ephah of flour, and a skin of wine, and brought him to the house of the Lord at Shiloh. And I wonder what Eli thought when it says when she had slaughtered the bull, she then brought the boy to Eli. Now, I wonder, and I get tickled here, because I wonder what Eli was thinking when she shows up to this kid and said, well, you know, you remember all these years ago when I was praying to the Lord, I was pouring myself out, and you blessed me. Well, I was asking for a child, and part of the deal was that I was going to give him to the Lord and give him to the temple and the service of the Lord. So, Eli, here he is. He's yours. You take him, and you train him up in the ways of the Lord and make him a prophet and a priest, and I'll be back every year to bring him a new coat, to bring him what he needs, all those kinds of things. Eli was probably shocked. She was saddened by it. There's no doubt that this was not an easy thing. This was not an easy sacrifice for her to make. But here it is, verse 26, and she said to him, as surely as you live, my Lord, I am the woman who stood here beside you praying to the Lord. I prayed for this child, and the Lord has granted me what I asked him. So now I give him to the Lord for his whole life. He shall be given to the Lord, and he worshiped the Lord there. And so that's the scripture, and it's amazing the lengths that she goes through to fulfill her promise to the Lord. And really, we should take a note of that and also understand that when we make a promise to God, we're obligated to that point to fulfill those promises, to fulfill those things that we have promised to God. But that's our lesson for this morning. I hope you received a blessing out of that, and hopefully you gain some new knowledge and understanding of God's Word. Again, next week we're going to look more into the life of Samuel. I'll just look ahead here in the book, and we're going to be in 1 Samuel chapter 3 next week and looking at that. And again, don't forget about our new schedule, Sunday morning 11 o'clock, Sunday night 6 o'clock, both face-to-face and live streaming. And then Wednesday night 7 o'clock for Bible study. That'll be live stream broadcast only. And then Sunday school, I'm calling it Sunday school, quote unquote. It'll be on Saturday mornings, 10 o'clock, also broadcast. And don't forget to visit our website. Click the Give Now button if you would like to pay your tithes, offerings online, mail those to the church, however you'd like to do that. It's up to you. And as always, if you need anything, don't forget to give me a call or send me a text message. And until next time, stay safe, and we'll see you then.
That flows by the throne of God, that flows by the throne of God.